Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. In this episode, I want to talk about tail call elimination. Now, you probably think of this in terms of recursion if you're likely to think of it at all, but I want to show you how it comes up in other ways that can make your generated code much more efficient and how our compilers take advantage of this. The idea is quite simple. If you return the result of a function from another function, then the compiler doesn't actually have to call that function. It can just jump to it. So let's illustrate. I went ahead and left up the ARM and x86 versions of this simply because I could. Now, see that I have a jump right here. Basically, the jump is just going to jump to the get value function. It doesn't set up any extra stack frame or anything like that. It just says jump to that other location, and then that function knows what it needs to do to return the value and such. In this particularly simple case, we can see that main is going to compile to literally just calling get value. It doesn't know what it's doing there, but it's been fully inlined. This works because they both return the same type. That is a huge help here. If one of them were to, for example, return a double, well, then I'm going to get a compilation failed because of a conversion error. And now we'll see what the compiler actually does here. Okay, good. It did something not overly simple. So in this case, I've got a function returning a double, calling a function that is returning an int. And this return value is not going to be stored in the same place. The return value from a function returning an int is going to be stored in the EAX register, and the return value from a function returning a double is going to be stored here in this XMMO register. And then we can see the compiler actually do this copy of the XMMO register into the EAX register for the return value from main. If I see that this now is also going to return a double, then the compiler can do this tail call again. So it's just going to jump to get value. It's like, hey, buddy, all the parameters, everything that you need, they're already in place. Just go ahead and do your job. I'm going to go back to doing int. And now I'm going to make this take a couple of parameters. Let's actually name them different. So that we can observe a little bit of difference here. Now, in this case, I am calling this other function and I take two parameters. But you may observe that the parameters that I'm taking, I am passing down to the next function in the same order. And I know that these are going to be in like RDI and RSI or EDI and ESI, and the compiler knows that as well. It knows that those two parameters were received in a certain place, and it knows that the next function is going to use the same calling conventions, and it's going to want those parameters in the same place again, so there's no work for it to do. In fact, I can add a third unused parameter here, and this is going to be fine. The compiler is still able to just jump to that other function. If I did something instead where I did perhaps y and z instead of x and y here, then the compiler is going to have to actually emit code to shuffle these parameters down. And we can see it copying ESI to EDI, copying EDX to ESI, and then it is able to call the getValue function. So I don't know if I would call this a premature optimization or not, but if you're aware of this kind of thing, then you could definitely structure your function call so that you always keep the same types of parameters in the same order when you're calling other functions. And then hopefully, if you're lucky, the compiler is able to optimize this in some meaningful way. I'm not sure if this is really something that would play out well in the real world, but it's something to be aware of, perhaps. In this case, it's able to leave the first register where it was, and it's then has to add y and z together into the correct register for the second parameter. Okay, so that's the general concept. Let's do other things. Like if I call get value here with x and y again, The compiler has no visibility into what this function does, so it can't optimize it away, and we'll see that it actually does have to set up the stack, it has to do work, it has to call the function, it has to restore things, and then it can do a tail call to get value. And so you might be slightly surprised to see that if I do something like this, because this is not a pure function, it has no visibility into it, we're going to find that it's not going to do a tail call for either of these things. It's going to do the two calls separately, independently, with their own call stacks, and then it's going to add the results of those two things together and clean up the stack and return from the function. So that's, again, the general idea. You tend to think of tail call elimination in terms of recursion, I said before. We can write some sort of summation function that sums from the input down to zero. We can write this recursively. And I can probably see, yes, that the compiler has removed my recursion through some, I don't know, magical something here, but I definitely don't have a tail call to my own self anymore. If I switch this one to Clang, then I will likely be able to observe, yes, that Clang actually finds the closed form version of this and just does the summation of a range of integers. You can read through the instructions yourself if you want to, and in fact, if you saw my recent episode on LEA, that will help you to better understand what this code is doing as well. Well, hopefully that was interesting. Thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. Be sure to subscribe. Catch you in the next episode.